Blessed be our God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The first reading today is from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up, and he shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces. He was despised and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him with stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole. And by his bruises, we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before his shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By provision of justice, he was taken away. We could have imagined his future, for he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken from the transgressions of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him, the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish, he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear the iniquities. Therefore, allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sin of many and made intercessions for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 22, verses 1 through 21. We will read responsibly. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning?
God, cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest.
yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame.
But I am a worm and no man, scorned by others and despised by the people.
All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads.
Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver, rescue the one who delights.
Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver him with rescue, the one in whom he delights. On you I saw cast from my birth, and since my mother bore me, you have been my God.
Do not be far from me.
Trouble is
near, and there is no one to help.
Many bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me.
They open wide.
They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion.
I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast.
My mouth is dried up
like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death.
For dogs are all around me. A company of evildoers encircles me. My hands and feet have shriveled.
I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me.
They divide my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots.
But you, O Lord,
do not be far away. Oh, help.
Come quickly
to myself, to my aid.
Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog.
Save me from the mouth of the lion. From the horns of the wild oxen, you have rescued me.
Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning.
It was in the beginning, it is now, and forever.
And will be forever. Amen. Okay.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Hebrews, chapter 10, beginning with the first verse. Since the law has only a shadow of the good things to come and not the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered year after year, make perfect those who approach. Otherwise, would they not have ceased being offered, since the worshipers, cleansed once for all, would no longer have any consciousness of sin? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sin year after year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." And I said, "See, God, I have come to do your will, O God. In the scroll of the book it is written of me." When he said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law." Then he added, "See, I have come to do your will." He abolishes the first in order to establish the second. And it is by God's will that we have been sanctified through the offerings of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stands day after day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, and since then has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us, for after saying, This is a covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds, he also adds. I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
for the first part of the passion until we reach the point of the skull, then you will stand.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went forth with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, procuring a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to befall him, came forward and said to them,
"Whom do you seek?"
They answered him,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus said to them,
"I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When he said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them,
"Whom do you seek?"
And they said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered them,
"I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill the word which he had spoken, "Of those whom thou gavest me, I lost not one." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword in its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup which the Father has given me?"
So the band of soldiers and their captain and the officers of the Jews seized Jesus and bound him. First they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had given counsel to the Jews that it was expedient that one man should die for the people. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. As this disciple was known to the high priest, he entered the court of the high priest along with Jesus. While Peter stood outside at the door, so the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the maid who kept the door and brought Peter in. The maid who kept the door said to Peter,
"Are not you also one of this man's disciples?"
And he said,
"I am not."
Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple where all Jews come together. I have said nothing secretly. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying,
"Is that how you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, bear witness to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They said to him,
"Are you not also one of his disciples?"
He denied it and said,
I am not.
One of the servants of the high priest, the kinsman of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
"Did I not see you in the garden with him?"
Peter again denied it, and at once the cock crowed. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was early. They themselves did not enter the praetorium so that they might not be defiled, but might eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
"What accusation do you bring against this man?"
They answered him,
"If this man were not an evildoer, we would not have handed him over to you."
Pilate then said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law."
The Jews said to him,
"It is not lawful for us to put any man to death."
This was to fulfill the word which Jesus had spoken to show by what death he was to die. Pilate entered the praetorium again and called Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered him,
"Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered him,
"My kingship is not of this world. If my kingship were of this world, my servants would fight that I might not be handed over to the Jews. But my kingship is not from the world."
Pilate said to him,
"So you are a king?"
Jesus answered,
"You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them,
"I find no crime in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. Will you have me release for you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this man, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a robber. Pilate took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them,
"See, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no crime in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, saying,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no crime in him."
The Jews answered him,
"We have a law, and by that law we ought to die. Because we have made him himself son of God."
When Pilate heard these words, he was the more afraid. He entered the praetorium again and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
But Jesus gave no answer. Pilate therefore said to him,
"You will not speak to me. Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me to you has the greater sin."
Upon this, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out,
"If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king sets himself against Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the pavement, and in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priest answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to him to be crucified. Please stand as you're able. So they took Jesus, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote a title and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. The chief priests of the Jews then said to Pilate,
"Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and made four parts, one for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was without seam, woven from top to bottom. So they said one to the other, "This was to fulfill the scripture, 'They parted my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots.'" So the soldiers did this, but standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished to fulfill the scripture, said,
"I thirst."
A bowl full of vinegar stood there. So they put a sponge full of the vinegar on hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the vinegar, he said,
"It is finished."
And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was a day of preparation, in order to prevent the bodies from remaining on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place that the scriptures might be fulfilled. Not a bone of him shall be broken. And again, another scripture says, they shall look on him whom they have pierced.
Make me thine forever. of the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I can never help coming to a Good Friday service and not remembering from my youth an old hymn that my parents, especially my mother, used to sing. I think about it and I've preached on it many times, but this year, for some reason, it seems a little even more special. It's that old hymn that says, I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. Every time I hear that, I can't help but remember as a youngster playing with my toys in our family's living room and hearing that song sung as part of the theme for a radio gospel program that my mother listened to constantly. I can even remember once as that song came over the radio wondering, what was this story of Jesus' love all about? Little did I know that approximately 25 years from that day, I would be called upon to answer what would amount to that very, very question. It happened on a Good Friday when I, as a deacon in a parish, was giving a talk to some children from the church who had gathered for a children's service we had that day. Few of the children wanted to know, what is the good in Good Friday? That is, what makes this Friday special or different from any other Friday? For them, every Friday was good, because that was the day, it was the last day of school, the weekend was coming, and all the exciting things you do on Saturday and so forth, and all that. What makes this day so special? Although the question was clear enough, it did for a moment catch me off guard. Had this been a group of adults, I, being a recent seminary graduate, could have perhaps dazzled them with a lengthy discussion on something like the doctrine of the atonement and used a bunch of those $50 theological words like the, oh, man's existential condition is really related to the eschatological understanding of God in their life, you know. I could have laid it on real nice. But since this was children, I knew I had to find a way of telling them the good news of God's love through Jesus Christ as revealed to us through the Good Friday experience. In my concern for how to tell the Good Friday story in a way I thought the children could truly comprehend it, at least enough to let it make a significant difference in their life, I realized that the best thing was to perhaps read that passion narrative together, and then I would have a better idea of what they did or didn't understand. In the process, I must admit, I was pleasantly surprised at how much of the gospel reading the children knew and identified with from their church school teaching. They complained about the injustice of the trial before Pilate. They related to the mockery and the taunting as something happens to them among their peers at school. They protested against the physical violence laid on Jesus as being too much like the violence they might face from neighborhood gangs or the bully on the corner. They cheered when Simon of Cyrene for at least helping to carry the cross. And they recognized the sadness of loved ones who had to watch Jesus die. For all of them knew someone in their family, whether it be a grandparent or a great aunt, whoever, who had died. Yet in all this, I could still feel present in their minds the question, well, where is the good in Good Friday? Where is the good in Good Friday? It was, however, at this point in the Passion narrative that something interesting happened to the children. They came to the point about the veil in the temple suddenly being torn in half at the death of Jesus. In the whole Passion story, this was the one thing that they had difficulty fitting into the realm of their young experience. They thought They had nothing that related to this, and they wanted to know what it all meant. So I took the time to explain how in the early Jewish temple, there was a special place called the Holy of Holies, which was divided from the rest of the holy places of the temple by a great veil. In the Holy of Holies, there was a throne called the Mercy Seat that was there for God to descend upon should God wish at some point to be with his people. No one is allowed to go into the Holy of Holies except the high priest once a year to bring on behalf of the people a special sacrifice for God's blessing. In other words, God was hid away behind a veil, and most individuals could not communicate with him. I explained to them that Jesus Christ, as our great high priest, has removed the veil. He has removed it, like a movie theater curtain is lifted, and the show begins. Only this time, we are a part of the scene with a God who loves us enough to even allow a part of his very self to go through the trials and the sorrows of the cross so that we might be given a chance for a new life, a new beginning with him. The veil is torn apart. It's open. The mercy seat is revealed. God is there. We can look, we can be welcomed in to him. Good Friday is good because it is the story of how God's love through Jesus Christ is open to all of us and proves that this love, even when it appears to be temporary and defeated, is still stronger than evil triumphant. And our job in this life is to tell this good and true story to others. Well, almost 30 years have come and gone since that day, and I can say for me that the story has still its powerful, powerful message. Yet as we come to Good Friday in 2022, we cannot help but be concerned at what we see happening all around us. The destruction of true moral values and the blatant disregard for life is becoming more and more apparent in our society, particularly among the younger generation, who express great pessimism about what they see as a very shaky future. We see it in the gun violence and the willingness for folks to just get a gun and shoot somebody because they had a beef or a squabble with them a few days ago. I suppose, however, if we could do a quick review of human life since its beginning, we would find in nearly every generation there are periods where the society appears to be falling apart. It is also in those times we would discover that the people who had some faith to draw upon, pulled themselves together, weathered the storm of life, and survived to encourage others, while those who either had no faith or somehow, some way, had lost it, fell by the wayside in a pool of bitter disappointment. You see, the Christian church was founded on a faith in the resurrection that happened as an outcome of the Good Friday experience. There is no Good Friday, there could be no Easter. Good Friday reminds us that although trials and tribulations are interwoven with our life, they are not the eternal result of life. The church must be about singing its song of hope, telling the old, old story of the eternal love, even when it seems we are singing that song in a very strange land, in a very strange situation, in a very difficult change in a society that may want to run from the good news. The church has got to tell that old, old story. Tell it in a new way, tell it in any way you can, but tell it that God's love is still there. God's love has not changed. God's love is still present. Jesus has brought us that love. You know, as African American living in a racist society, I know the Good Friday experience. I know it well, and over my life I have experienced it many, many times. Good Friday is very familiar to me. I see it, and there is something to remind me of it every day. But I have been able to survive and keep on keeping on because I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in time my faith in his love will lift me to my Father, who is also your Father, to my God, who is also your God. Love lifts us up where we belong, from life's slaveship to Christ's championship, from disgrace to the open arms of God's amazing grace. May all our hearts sing out this Good Friday with the love of our crucified Lord, and be prepared, as always, to rise with him in that love this Easter and forevermore. Christ has made a way. The veil has been cut in two. The presence of God through Christ is made available to you and to me. Let us rise with him. Let us sing that great old story of Jesus and his love. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now unto God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we ascribe what is most justly due, all might, majesty, dominion, and power, this Good Friday day and forevermore.
Amen.
Amen.
Calvary's fire.
The solemn colonnades. This will be found on page 12 in your bulletin or on page 277 in your Book of Common Prayer. Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent His Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. That all who believe in Him might be delivered from the power of sin and death and become heirs with Him of everlasting life. We pray therefore for people everywhere according to their needs. Let us pray for the Holy Catholic Church of Christ throughout the world, for its unity in witness and service, for all bishops and other ministers, and the people whom they serve, for William, our bishop, and all the people of his diocese, for all Christians in this community, for those about to be baptized, that God will confirm his church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive all supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth, and for those in authority among them. For Joseph, the President of the United States, for the Congress and the Supreme Court, for the members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth, and live in peace and concord. Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your dominion may increase, until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body and in mind, for the hungry and the homeless, the destitute and the oppressed, for the sick, the wounded and the crippled, for those in loneliness, fear and anguish, for those who face temptation, doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and captives, for those in mortal danger, that God in His mercy will comfort and relieve them and grant them the knowledge of His love and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs. Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer. Let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ, for those who have never heard the word of salvation, for those who have lost their faith, for those hardened by sin or indifference, for the contemptuous and the scornful, for those who are enemies of the cross of Christ and persecutors of his disciples, for those who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to the truth and lead them to faith and obedience. Merciful God, creator of all the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us commit ourselves to God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have departed this world and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery, by the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility in the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
I will clear. action for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll tell.
Son and of the Holy Spirit, go.
Amen.
Christ for our sakes became obedient unto death.
Even the death of the cross.
By his own blood he entered once into the holy place.
Having obtained eternal redemption for us.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and passion hath redeemed us.
Save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, who for the redemption of the world didst walk the way of the cross and bore in thy sinless self the sins of the many, grant that we, following in thy footsteps, may obtain increase of thy love and walk all the days of our life in thy paths, who now liveth and reigneth with the Father and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
Now let hearts be filled with wonder as the holy way we trace, where our Savior trod before us, who is first of all our race, then in gaining our salvation, he might blot out our disgrace.
Jesus is condemned to death.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord of justice standing before the judgment seat. Pilate washes his hands. The rulers of Judea take his blood upon their heads and on their children. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
He spared not his own son,
but delivered him up for all of us.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, condemned to death for our sins, grant us true repentance, that being washed in that stream which flows from Calvary through the sacraments of thy holy church to the end of time, we may evermore serve thee with pure hearts and minds, who now livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end.
Amen.
See how Pilate makes ablution as the crowd shall crucify, who in cowardly surrender, owning Caesar's Christ deny, thus condemning him, their Maker, on a shameful cross to die.
Jesus receives the cross.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord in whom all things subsist, who led his people out of Egypt and into the land of milk and honey, now led off to death, carrying the instrument of his condemnation. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
The Lord have laid on him the iniquity of us all.
For the wickedness of my people, he has stricken him.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, who has taught us to pray, thy will be done, and who have said, except ye take your cross and follow me, ye have no part in me. Grant us by thy grace cheerfully so to bear the slights and discouragements, the frustrations and temptations of the daily round with patience and humility, that we may be made one with thee who bore thy cross for us, and who now livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end.
Amen.
See his shoulder now that burden, bending beneath the cursed tree. Awesome lesson now providing, how at one with him to be. He must take our cross and follow in the selfsame path as he.
Jesus falls the first time.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord by whom all things were made. He falls in the dust, his agony and bloody sweat, the rigors of his final trial, the mocking and the scourging, now take their toll. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
Surely he hath borne our griefs
and carried our sorrows.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, accept our humble thanks for that thou didst bear the full weight and pay the price of sin, that we might have its full weight lifted from our souls, who would be weighed down indeed and lost forever, but for thee and thine abiding grace, who now liveth and reigneth with the Father and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen. He lifts our fallen nature, low now falls amidst the din, bearing more than cross his burden, grievous load of all our sin, deeper far more sharply cutting, is the weight he bears within.
Jesus meets his holy mother.
I'm sorry. We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the handmaid of the Lord, together with her son. The ancient Simeon's word to her is now fulfilled. A sword shall pierce thine own soul also. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
Yea, a sword shall pierce thine own soul also,
that the thoughts of many hearts shall be revealed.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, at whose presentation in the temple the aged Simeon prophesied the piercing of the compassionate heart of the Blessed Virgin Mary, grant that we may be aided by her deep devotion and lifted by her prayers before thee, who now livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen. Sealing thou his holy mother, gazing on her son once fair, who with sweat and blood all matted, thorny crown thus patient wear, see fulfill the early warning, as her soul is pierced there.
And the cross is laid on Saint Simon of Cyrene.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord who holds the whole world in the hollow of his hand, now upheld by Simon, who was standing in the crowd, and whom soldiers pressed to service, who from the sharing in the passion of our Lord became a saint of Holy Church. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy on us.
Whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me
cannot be my disciple.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, who has taught us to take up our cross and follow thee, grant us so to grow through every burden of the daily round, that we may share our cross with thee, who shared thy cross with blessed Simon, and who now liveth and reigneth with the Father and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen. See how Simon pressed to service, by the Roman soldiery, bears his cross and finds his master. So by grace of God may we, bearing all our load with patience. Find it even as it be.
Saint Veronica wipes the face of Jesus.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord of beauty, Saint Veronica, who loves him much, runs to cleanse his face, to whom the church has given as a name her deed itself, Veronica, for image of the Lord, which legend says he left upon her cleansing cloth. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
Have mercy upon us.
Hide not thy face far from me.
Put not thy servant away in anger.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, who has taught us that inasmuch as we have been merciful unto one of the least of thy brethren, we have been so unto thee. Grant us grace to be sensitive to the need of friend and foe alike, that like as the blessed Veronica found thy image on the cloth which mercy gave, so may we bear imprinted upon our hearts the image of thy love, who now livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen. See, we have a thoughtful maiden who is fully faced in thee. Find his image permanent on a cloth which mercy gave. So to ask the kindness ever, Jesus worketh thee in grace.
Jesus falls the second time.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold, the Lord of heaven fallen to the earth again, its burdens on his shoulders. The cross becomes the outward sign of all our sins, and sin's intolerable weight. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
But I am a worm and no man.
The reproach of men and despise of the people.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, who didst walk the lonely road of life to death itself, that men might need never to be alone again, help all who stumble in blindness of heart, searchings of mind, and loneliness of soul, that they may come to know thee, who art the light of the world, and who now liveth and reigneth with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen. How we to the Father offer all who suffer grievous pain, and then contemplate how Jesus every living draws again, while his bruised and bleeding body purples earth with sacred stain.
Jesus meets the women of Jerusalem.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord whom prophets long foretold. There follows him a great company of disciples, of women which also bewail and lament him to whom he prophesies. Daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. If they do these things in a green tree, what shall be done in the dry? Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
They that sow in tears
shall reap in joy.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, who has taught us to lay up for ourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break not through nor steal, grant that as we walk through the midst of this crumbling world, our hearts may be stayed on thee, who art the goal of all our striving and the answer to our restlessness, who now livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen.
Lord, the willing loudly wailing, hear Messiah prophesy. Woeful tidings unto Salem, who sent forth their king to die. King eternal may he show us where our joy and true peace lie.
Jesus falls the third time.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord, who when he has been lifted up, will draw all men unto him, now falls a third and painful time. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
He is brought as a sheep to the slaughter,
and was mute as a lamb before the shearers.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, by the merits of this thy holy cross, strengthen me, that I may never fall into grievous willful sin, and should I, through carelessness or ignorance, offend thee, grant that I may quickly turn to thee with contrite heart, honest confession, and full purpose of amendment, to conquer all that ought not be in me, through thy grace, who now liveth and reigneth with the Father and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
Amen.
May the third of fall most painful on a stony path and steep, that our sins may be forgiven, stir in us contrition deep, fill us with a firm desire, his most holy will to keep.
Jesus is stripped of his garments.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord who clothed the world in beauty, who now submits for love of man to man all man's hatred. He is stripped of his clothing and prepared for the cross. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
They gave me also gall for my meat,
and in my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, now prepared for the gallows tree, help us to strip off all false pride and to be clothed with sincerity of heart. Let love rule in our hearts and fill them so that no room remains for anger. Let us rejoice in the success of others and pray for them in their shortcomings, that we may have no room for the cloak of envy. For lust, give us singleness of purpose, that all our desires live in the pure crucible of this thy holy sacrifice. Grant us for greed a love of holy poverty, for sloth a holy industry, for gluttony a wholesome discipline, that resisting all temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil, we may live in faith, through hope, with love by thee, who now livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God,
world without end.
Amen.
Amen.
May the stripping of his garments and the cheery crops and I and the robes so seamless woven close to casting of the die strip off from us all pretensions. All our boasting nullify.
Jesus is nailed to the cross.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by the holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord of love. The soldiers nail him to the cross. He praying to the Father for them. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
They pierced my hands and my feet.
I may tell all my foes, they stand and stare upon me.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, stretching out thine arms to the nails and praying for the nailers. May the light of thy holy gospel and the healing of thy sacramental grace reach out yet more and more till all mankind shall nail its sins to the cross for love of thee, who now liveth and reigneth with the Father and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
See we how we pray forgiveness while the multitude doth rail.
Jesus dies on the cross.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the Lord of life and glory saying, it is finished. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. The saving victim is become the mighty victor. Sin, Satan, and death are defeated. There is darkness over all the earth. The rocks are rent. The graves open. The veil of the temple is torn in twain. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
Christ became obedient unto death,
even the death of the cross.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, whose sacred side was pierced that blood and water flowing out therefrom might reveal thy death was by a broken heart. Accept the lowly offering of my heart's love and grant that dying unto self, I may live only unto thee, who died for me and now liveth and reigneth with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen. Love and thanks and praise address we, as with gaze contented live. See I now our Christ, our Savior, hung and died that we might live, and with glory adoration, all our heart's best offering give.
The body of Jesus is taken down from the cross.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the handmaid of the Lord, receiving into her hands the body of her Son, our Lord. His life work finished, his soul released, his victory won amidst death, defeat. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
Her tears are on her cheeks.
She hath none to comfort her.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, by the merits of thy precious death and burial, grant that all who mourn for loss of loved ones may know the help of her prayers, whose arms receive thy sacred body. May the sure and certain hope of the resurrection be unto them a strong staff with which to walk the paths ahead, guided by thy light, who livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end.
Amen.
Amen.
Though her arms so slowly riven, with compassion's piercing sword, Mary now receives the body of God's only Son, our Lord, Jesus, whom the world rejected, evermore by hosts adored.
The body of Jesus is laid in the tomb.
We adore thee, O Christ, and we bless thee.
Because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world.
Behold the body of our Lord laid in Joseph's tomb, the penalty of Adam paid. The seed, which except it be sown, abides alone, now awaiting resurrection and a harvest of the souls of men for ages yet untold. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy upon us.
Thou wilt not leave my soul in hell,
nor will thou suffer thy holy one to see corruption.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, who whilst thy sacred body was at rest on the Sabbath, didst in nether realms establish thy reign and preach to the souls departed, grant that not on either side of the grave may ever separate us from thy love, who having heralded hell and brought captivity captive, now liveth and reigneth ever one God, world without end. Amen. Amen.
See we now our Savior's body, born in sadness through the gloom. Blessed body, strength of Mary, hallowed now the rocking tomb. See the Sabbath hill arising, he his glory shall
Glory be to God the Father, glory to his only Son, lowly victim, mighty victor,
reigning now his conflict done.
Glory to the Holy Spirit, who from both with both is one. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O blessed Lord Jesus, thou living stone, rejected of the builders, and become the chief stone of the corner. Grant that, building upon thy sure foundation, we may share thy everlasting habitation, who now liveth and reigneth with the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
Congregation to join us in singing together the anthems.
It's found there on page 17. We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us. Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you.
Because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world.
If we have died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you. Because by your holy Christ you have redeemed the world.
The hymn before communion is Our Holy Jesus. Service continues with the confession. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you of all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take the remembrance that Christ has died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Amen.
Body and blood of Christ, the body and blood of our salvation.
Amen.
Body and blood of Christ, the body and blood of our salvation.
Amen.
Body and blood of Christ, the body and blood of our salvation. Amen. For peace to love and serve the Lord. Keep you unto everlasting life. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. Body of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. Body of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. Everlasting life. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. Savior Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. The body, O Lord, bread of heaven. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, keep you unto everlasting life. Amen. Sometimes it causes me to tremble.
Hide, my Lord.
Say together our prayer of thanksgiving before we venerate the cross. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment in our souls. Now in the hour of our death, give mercy and grace to the living, pardon and rest to the dead, to your holy church, peace and concord, and to us sinners, everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.